Hi, welcome to the fifth lecture of thermodynamics. Let us start with the point temperature dependent internal energy. Now, what is the dependence of internal energy on the temperature? See, as the temperature of a system is raised, means increased, the internal energy increases. Now, why? Because the various modes of motion like translation, rotation become more highly excited. So, when we increase the temperature, the various modes of motion like translation, rotation become more highly excited, and due to this, the internal energy also increases. Then, what is the dependence of enthalpy on the temperature? See, similar to internal energy, the enthalpy of a substance also increases as its temperature is raised. So, these two points are important for the multiple choice questions based examination. What is the effect of temperature on internal energy and enthalpy? So, both get increased when we increase the temperature. This is the answer. Now, second important point, reversible and irreversible adiabatic expansion. So, we have to derive the expressions for these two processes, reversible adiabatic expansion and irreversible adiabatic expansion. But before that, we should know what is the difference between reversible process and irreversible process. So, let us summarize these differences. The first difference is, in case of reversible process, the process is carried out infinitesimally slowly. Okay, while in case of irreversible process, it is carried out rapidly. So, this is the first main difference. Reversible process is slower, while irreversible process is rapid. Second point of difference is, at any stage, the equilibrium is not disturbed in case of reversible process. While in irreversible process, equilibrium may exist only after the completion of the process. Third point of difference, reversible process takes infinite time for completion. So, there is no finite time. It takes infinite time for its completion. And in case of irreversible process, it takes a finite time for the completion. Fourth point of difference is, work obtained in this process is maximum. In reversible process, work obtained is maximum, while in case of irreversible process, work obtained is not maximum. So, these are the four main point of differences between reversible process and irreversible process. You should know that differences before we move on. Then, what is mean by adiabatic process? You all know very well that the adiabatic process is a process in which no heat transfer takes place. So, heat cannot enter into the system or out of a system. So, that type of processes are called as adiabatic processes. Now, we will see the first expression, reversible adiabatic expansion. Okay, in examination, there can be a 5 marks question, derive an expression for the reversible adiabatic expansion. So, in case of a written examination, and there are many small points in this expression which are important for the multiple choice questions based examination. Let us start. See, the change in internal energy U, we denote internal energy by the sign capital U, and change, that is delta U, can be written as it is equal to Q plus W. So, according to first law of thermodynamics, we have seen that delta U is equal to Q plus W, where Q is the amount of heat transferred to the system, while W is the work done on the system. Okay, So as we are deriving expression for the adiabatic process, no heat transferred into or out of the system. So Q is equal to 0. So this first equation is become delta U is equal to W, because Q is equal to 0 here. So delta U is equal to W. Now the reversible expansion is performed continuously at equilibrium by means of infinitesimal changes in pressure P. So we are varying the pressure. So the corresponding infinitesimal work done, that is when we consider smaller work, we have to write delta W, okay, is equal to minus PdV. Why minus PdV? Because infinitesimal changes in pressure P there. So delta W is equal to minus PdV. And for an ideal gas, the internal energy U only depends on amount of substance N and temperature T. Since N is constant in a closed system, the change in internal energy U is shown by dU is equal to CV dT. So after writing delta U is equal to W, we have derived two terms. First one is delta W is equal to minus PdV. So we have to put that term in place of W. Then we have derived dU is equal to CV dT. We have to put that term in place of that delta U. So this equation become, equating dU and delta W gives us CV dT is equal to minus PdV. Okay, what we get? CV dT is equal to minus PdV. Then we know that PV is equal to nRT. Okay, therefore CV dT is equal to, instead of P we have to write nRT upon V. So minus nRT upon V into dV. Okay, then bring that T to this side, so it become CV upon T into dT is equal to minus nR upon V into dV. Okay, this is our expression, CV upon T dT is equal to minus nR upon V dV. So we have to integrate this equation from initial state T1 V1 to T2 V2. So see here, integration T1 to T2 CV upon T dT is equal to integration from V1 to V2 minus nR upon V dV. Okay, now in this case, take that CV which is constant at outside that integral. So integration of 1 of T dT from T1 to T2 is equal to here minus nR, again it is constant, take outside the integral. So integration V1 to V2 up of 1 upon V into dV. So after solving this integral, we can write CV ln of T2 upon T1. Okay, 1 upon T. So here become ln of T2 upon T1 is equal to minus nR ln of V2 upon V1. Now take that CV on opposite side. So we get ln of T2 upon T1 is equal to minus nR upon CV ln of V2 upon V1. Okay, now take antilog of it. So T2 upon T1 is equal to what we get? See carefully this step. T2 upon T1 is equal to V2 upon V1 raised to. So that part become raised to of that V2 upon V1. So V2 upon V1 is equal raised to minus nR upon CV. So what we get? T2 upon T1 is equal to V1 upon V2. So when we change that 2, that is take that denominator into numerator, while numerator into denominator, so there is a change in sign of that raised to part. So V1 upon V2 become raised to R upon CMV. Now why CMV here? CMV is the molar heat capacity at constant volume. Okay, so you have to study all these, you have to study all these steps carefully, what we have done here. Okay, now since CMP minus CMV, so we have introduced M here, it is a for molar. Okay, and V is for a molar heat capacity at constant volume, and when we write CMP, it is the molar heat capacity at constant pressure. Now since we know that CMP minus CMV is equal to R. You know very well that Cp minus Cv is equal to R. But in term of molar, we can write CMP minus CMV is equal to R. So the exponent can be rewritten T2 upon T1. Again, we have continued with this equation. Okay, so T2 upon T1 is equal to V1 upon V2 R upon CMV. This is our last equation. Now, instead of this R, we have to write CMP minus CMV. So, when we put the value of R, CMP minus CMV, then it becomes CMP minus CMV upon CMV. So, by solving it, we get CMP upon CMV minus 1. So, when we do paperwork, we will obtain this. Instead of R, you have to put CMP minus CMV. Okay. So, that CMP minus CMV upon that CMV, it will give you that CMP upon CMV minus 1. Okay. So, we can write T2 upon T1 is equal to V1 upon V2 raised to gamma minus 1. Now, why gamma here? So, CMP upon CMV is equal to gamma. See here, gamma is the ratio of heat capacities. Gamma, we can write Cp upon Cv or CMP upon CMV or small Cp upon small Cv. And for a monoatomic ideal gas, the CMP is equal to 5/2 R and CMV is equal to 3/2 R. So these values are for the monoatomic ideal gas, and thus gamma is equal to 5/3. So we have just put the gamma in place of CMP upon CMV. Okay. Note that in our expression, given expression, the volumes V1 and V2 are unknown. However, the values for the pressure P1 and P2 are given. And we know that PV is equal to nRT. So, we have derived expression on the previous page that T2 upon T1 is equal to V1 upon V2 raised to gamma minus 1. So, by rearranging it, we can write T2 into V2 raised to gamma minus 1. So that is, it is V1 raised to gamma minus 1 upon V2 raised to gamma minus 1. So that V2 raised to gamma minus 1 change the side and comes with the T2. So here become T2 into V2 raised to gamma minus 1 is equal to that T1 again change side and comes to side of V1. So T1 into V1 raised to gamma minus 1. Now, for T2, we can write PV upon nR from this equation. What is the value of T? T is equal to that PV upon nR. So, here instead of T2, we can write P2 V2 upon nR into V2 raised to gamma minus 1. And for T1, we can write P1 V1 upon nR into V1 raised to gamma minus 1. Okay. So, that nR get cancelled. So we get P2 into V2 into V2 raised to gamma minus 1 is equal to P1 into V1 into V1 raised to gamma minus 1. So that V2 into V2 raised to gamma minus 1 gives us V2 raised to gamma. Similarly, V1 into V1 raised to gamma minus 1 gives us V1 raised to gamma. So that raised to get added because there is a multiplication between that V terms. So their raised to gets added. So P2 into V2 raised to gamma is equal to P1 into V2 raised to gamma. So our equation become P2 upon P1 is equal to V1 upon V2 raised to gamma. So this is our final equation. What we have derived, P2 upon P1 is equal to V1 upon V2 raised to gamma. So, this is the expression for the reversible adiabatic expansion. You have to write down this expression carefully into in your notebook. Solve each step carefully so you will understand what the actual expression is this. Okay, in the next lecture we will study the irreversible adiabatic expansion. Thank you.